Hello, hello. Hey, Barbara. Super nice to have you here in our Stones and Glasses Hyper Year interviews. And yeah, super. Thank you so much for making the time to be here. Your work is so inspiring to us and to so many people. And I would love to dedicate this hour to get to know you a bit better, get to know your motivations. I think your story is very incredible. And we could start by you maybe just sharing a bit who you are and why are you here? Like, why are you here? Why did you get to this place of doing what you do? I think this will be very interesting to know.
Cool. Hey, it's so good to be here, Pedro. I love the fact that we get to chat. We haven't chatted in 2 years, and then we get to do it for other people to access it too. So I am a journalist. My background is in journalism, and many years after I had created Mesa, I started understanding how much of editing there is. Like, if I weren't a magazine editor, Mesa would not exist. But I didn't see it when I was first thinking about it. So I worked with magazines for many years, and that led me to Fabrica, the Benetton Communication Center in Italy. I ended up becoming editor-in-chief of Colors, and Colors had always been kind of my dream magazine. If I were to think, like, what's the top of this career? It would be editor-in-chief of Colors. So when that happened, I kind of felt I had the chance to create my own work. I was also at Fabrica at this point, which is a place that I feel sends you very close to yourself, like to your essence. You're in the middle of nowhere, this weird place, this Tadauando building, which is amazing. And you get to really kind of just hear yourself, And so one day I wrote down this formula, which was a leader, a team. The first formula was a leader, a diverse team, and a project you have to finish, which now has evolved into a leader at the head of the table, a team that has every single piece of knowledge and skill that you need, and one mission. And so this is what we do now at Mesa. We assemble teams, like we form leaders, and we assemble extraordinary teams to work together with a very tangible mission. We have to really finish something in that space of usually 5 days, but it could be less, could be more. We've done 7-day mazes in the past. So that's what I do. That's where I come from. I'm also a mother of three kids, which proves three boys that are very close in age. So I had, was pregnant. I had a child, I was pregnant, had another child. And so I think that says a lot about my energy, my level of energy, and how much I kind of like the chaos and being on the movement all the time.
Yeah, this is really interesting. I mean, I know that you have been applying this methodology or this this methodology in several contexts with several organizations, from very, very big organizations, from Coca-Cola. I think I even did a sprint with Kobe Bryant, if I'm not
Yeah, we
wrong.
did a
So
mezzo for him.
you have some much experience dealing with organizations that are large, that have a how do you say, that have a history, that have already lots of processes in place and a lots of bureaucracy and a lots of legacy in ways of doing things. And then you come up with like this 5 to 7 day place where all those people that are used to work in a particular routine with a particular expectations of deliverable can break that and create something that they wouldn't imagine being possible. And why is that possible? And how can you bring people to this space? Because for everybody hearing here as well, we all know that like it's very hard to break processes. It's very hard to break legacy. All of those things, they really stagnate with us in organizational context. How do you bring people to break that and get this new paradigm of collaboration?
I think it's interesting because I think the word legacy is very different from the idea of like the process they're already implemented. So I think as MESA, we have deep respect for companies' legacies, and that shows. So I think that's the first thing, like when a MESA leader comes to, like meets someone who wants to buy a MESA, and at first it feels really weird that we are saying that I need 5 days of the main decision makers, like I need the CEO for 5 days. It feels, when I'm saying this to people, I can see their reaction. They feel like I'm being impolite, that I like, you know, that's not good manners to say 5 days of your CEO. So it's so radically weird that this also opens them up a little bit. And then we are very respectful of the knowledge a client brings. So when I came into, imagine I'm a journalist and there was no concept of client when you work on a magazine, right? Like you make decisions based on a reader. It's very different. And when I came into advertising, because when I came back from Fabric, I went into an ad agency. For me, it was very surprising the relationship that those people had with their clients. It was like they were either serving them to a point where they were doing whatever they wanted. There was always this idea that, oh, it's the client. And then when the client wasn't present, they were being very hostile towards the client. The client was this person that stopped them from doing the great thing. And for me, it was very weird. For me, like, that makes no sense, because the client, in my mind, is the person who knows a lot more about that organization than I can ever know. Like, the people who go to bed and wake up thinking of those problems, those dimensions, those dynamics, they are the one that know that organization. And respecting that really makes a difference. And so I think because our clients see that, then they are able to say, okay, whatever you say. And they surrender. We kind of ask them to surrender to something new. A lot of times my conversation is, I'm not going to explain to you what's going to happen on Wednesday at 4 p.m. They want to know. And I'm like, I'm not. You know, it's just going to be what it is. It's real-time decision. I need 5 days of your life. So we also don't go into the process that much, because there isn't. Because actually, if you want to go from a problem to a solution for real, without stopping at the debate phase, the problematic phase, then you will need to do whatever it takes. And it's very different, you know, like you can see a pattern when you look at the method. We are able to map a pattern, like a macro overview. But what happens at 4 p.m. on Wednesday, no one knows. And that's literally something that a client like Coca-Cola was asking at the beginning. They were saying, I need to know what happens at a certain hour because I might need to take a call. And we were like, no, you're not taking a call. But you cannot be doing anything else. You surrender to this universe, and the promise is really high, right? Like our promise is, I'm going to find you a solution. I'm going to build you a solution in 5 days. So there is, and I feel also there is always a person on the other side in order for you to succeed in convincing someone to change that much of a process. There is a person on the other side who is a visionary, like who is able to trust this promise. It's like, I don't know what I'm delivering. I don't know what I'm doing every step of the way, but I'm delivering an extraordinary solution in 5 days. So there is a level of surrender, like on this person as well, this ability of being more innovative than the rat, you know, like the average person who's in love with the current processes, you know.
And also, what does it say about presence? I think, like, if you look at our context, right, we are all exposed to like all social medias and so many channels of information all the time, and we kind of split our personalities and our attention in so many channels. And then we, on top of this, work in organizations that have like a complexity of layers and processes. And basically, living in this context, you just basically then take people out of this context and says, okay, now we want 100% of presence, and we want you to forget all this hierarchy and just sit here and really work for the purpose of what we want to reach here. And I guess that you call mission, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting because that's the major change, right? Like, if you think about it, 5 days is not, it's not like a short period of time. Because I'm talking about 60 hours where every single piece of knowledge that you need is a chair away from you or a window away from you if it's in the remote format. Of one thing, like I ask you to dedicate yourself to one thing. Like in real work, to dedicate 60 hours to something, it takes 6 months. So actually, yeah. Mesa is, do you know what I mean? Like it's not a short. So the difference is that, like that we are saying, you're going to do one thing. I need your full presence. And it's really hard. And the more, you know, it's, we are so addicted to like the, all the possibilities. I'm not even sure addicted is the right word because I don't have a judgmental view on this. For me, it's like, of course, as humans, if I know I am able to do 3,000 things at this minute, I want to do 3,000 things, you know, you give me possibilities, I want to jump on them, you know, I think it's natural. So it's really hard, and I think it's going to become harder and harder to really stop and do one thing. But once you do it, it's a superpower, right? Because you actually go from, you're able to structure thinking, you're able to move into an attempt and then see a mistake and do an attempt again at once. In a one shot. And that's very valuable. And so I think everyone, like the first time you talk to people about presence, they want to react back. They want to say, no way. You don't want to, our cell phones are part of our body, really, right, these days. I can see when we do remote format, we have people have to stand and place their mobile away from their body reach and their vision. Because otherwise, it's much harder for them not to reach out and read the message, you know? So you really have to, it's not a natural thing for us anymore to just disconnect completely. But it's really powerful.
One question that I have, because I mean, I think like I'm 100% convinced that the Mesa format is unique. I mean, I had the chance to also do your course, your like school, and it's fantastic methodology. What I'm really interested here is like after the COVID situation and all the like ways of work changing so much, people want to move in the countryside, they want to work remote, they are like, there's so much conversation about life work-life balance and all of those things. What I wonder, and I do think there is something in here and into what you're doing that actually speaks to a broader solution, because I think we are in times where we need to rethink the ways we work. And as you're saying, like, if we are able to make 6 months happen in 5 days, like, should we not think about ways of working where we really focus the interaction and then resolve a lot of things, then create some breathing spaces in between? What is a work life balance? What is the balance, and how much could this potentially also inform and inspire organizations to change the way that they do things? And that would be very interesting to hear.
I think it's interesting because when you describe this, you know, the image that you just gave us, right? Like you work 5 days and then the rest of the time you were like breathing, you're resting, like you're in nature, right? I think this is a description that really speaks to me. Like, I love that idea. We would joke like a week doing a maze, a week at the beach, perfect life, to then come back, prepare the next one. At the same time, what I've learned is that it's not for everyone the description of a perfect work and life balance. And I think what is going to be really hard, you know, from now on is that different people will have different needs in terms of how they want to work. There won't be a perfect, you know, like for one, like you can do one setup. I personally, like the people we are attracting are people who want to live in a small town and they can work from anywhere and they can lead teams and assemble teams. And the teams are better now because, right, like I could, for example, there is this really great motion designer from Taiwan that we, it's like best motion ever. And no one wants to pay for a motion designer to fly to Taiwan, you know, like to a different country. It's like, oh, come on, let's just find a motion designer that is local, right? And then all of a sudden you were able to access that talent. So I see a lot of value on that. I see a lot of value on the connections becoming more accurate and you find the people that you need and it's global. I think that work model will allow global companies to expand. And, you know, like you, if you get people, so I think a lot of companies will embrace this lifestyle, which is focus for a while and then be where you want to be. Focus for a while and take more vacation days. At the same time, that's it. I see a lot of people who feed from different balances. Like some people want to be going a little bit of work, 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the afternoon, every day, you know. Some people don't want to work on Friday now, right? Like it's a huge thing. Some people really like, for them, it's more important. And for me, that's a weird move. Like I work on Saturday. I work on, do you know what I mean? Like for me, it's a different day. And then sometimes I'll take vacation. I have 3 kids. We'll go and do an adventure. For me, I see what you're envisioning.
I was just curious. And I also think, I mean, we are a remote first company and we are about 25 people working full time. We're relatively small from everywhere. And we are collaborating with like a much larger amount of people. And I think one of the things for us that we needed to figure out, and I mean, of course, as we are also helping organizations to implement this remote work, it's like really respecting the different rhythms of different people and trying to accommodate that. So we have people that start at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We have people in another country that is starting there. And so I guess one of the balances that we figured, it's like you need to have a good structure that creates some moments for people to be together. Then you have to have like a good channel-based communication structure and then some asynchronous ways of communicating, right? I think, and yes. For us, this was very difficult.
What are you guys using for asynchronous? Like,
we use Notion, Loom, use like Google Drive, and then we use
the guys audio. Right? Is there like a lot of audio in the communication?
No, we use just Loom. You know Loom?
No,
Loom is just like a video. It's like a video based communication where you just click. And then it takes a video of what you're doing on your computer and then you just share it with everybody. So it's, and then you can create threads or videos showing things to each other. But yes, we use Discord. So there is no audio. And I mean, I love audio. Sometimes I miss the audio, but I don't like the audio because it's very hard to know when. And then you really need to give presence, right, on the audio. So it's like that. For me personally, it's like, okay, it's really hard to then go back to like, oh, what was said then? Unless you had some audio with transcriptions, I don't know. But yes, we don't do it. So yes.
Love the video you grab.
It's really good. Loom is very, very, exactly. And then just figuring out, I mean, Loom, it generates already like a link and then you can post it anywhere. So it generates a video and uploads it. So you can post it anywhere have a conversation around those. Yes, but this like synchronous and asynchronous way of working, it's like really fundamental and having like a good structure for that. And I guess that's exactly what you said. It's like for this new way of working is like, how can we understand the people's personal motivation and how can you accommodate a structure that then allows them to be able to work the way they want and still be productive and still work within an engine, like let's say within a broader structure.
Yeah.
And I guess this is a real challenge. And I totally agree with you that, we need to see what people actually want and every person is different.
So the thing is, it's hard to also design for everyone. It's kind of impossible. So then it kind of, you start doing it the way you do it and attract the people that like the way you do it, which is a strength, but then becomes less diverse, and then you've got to work on how to make it, you know, for more people. But I think it's like the eternal movement of things, you know, trying to understand, like, does my organization hold, because in order for you to be able to have really great remote experience as you were describing, and really great experiences for people who like a little more like synchronous community, only being in the presence of other people. We lost a lot of people from Mesa Company's team during the pandemic, because it was the pandemic, of course, but also the fact that it was no longer in real life. For a lot of people, it felt like it lost its magic, you know? Yeah. Like for them, being in the presence of other people was more important than the idea of being global, the idea of being connected to extraordinary talent, no matter where they are, the idea of respecting people's individuality. Fair enough, you know, and they left, and it's a tough one. Running an organization is always like the most complex challenge of the
world. Yeah. I guess also like the world is changing all the time and you have to adapt. And I think we get confronted with this situation all the time. And it's like, we're not dictating the context, the macro context of the world. And when the macro context is changing, you can decide to be an organization that's stubborn and doesn't change, or you just can adapt faster than others and take the advantage there. And that's, I think sometimes people just have the stubbornness of like not willing to understand. And I often have this conversation with people. It's like, it's not about what I think is cool. It's just like the world is more complex than that, and there are trends and things that change, and we need to just understand and act upon them. And I think that's something that we need to take into consideration.
It's true, but also hard, right? Like, it's easier to be a small company that moves fast, and it's one of the reasons, for example, I've never dreamt of having hundreds of employees, right? Like, the dream, I always say 12 is my number. I would love to be just 12. We're more than 12 already, but in a way, it's kind of, I'm building to this moment where you can be very light, so you can change really quickly. But it's hard, right? Because you want to grow, like, the more impact you want to cause, then you need more structure. And what's the minimal viable structure without pressuring people also to deliver more than they should be? You know, it's a hard one. I don't know.
It's definitely a hard balance.
I think it's interesting to look at it from that complexity, just because also it reminds us again that the people who are not changing that fast, you know, we've got to understand their reasons too.
No, absolutely. You got to understand their reasons, but you can't change the fact that they will have less advantage moving forward for not having changed.
Yeah, and because you will have to change.
That truth. Yes.
It's going to be harder for some.
And how is it for you? So you do the Mesa now over like a Zoom or some technology like this?
Yeah, we do any platform. We're very agnostic when it comes to the platforms, which was something that first we thought, let's just be really great at Zoom. And we understood our clients, some of them use Microsoft, some of them use Google. So
some people love Microsoft Teams.
There is a safety issue, right? Like, the challenges that we solve, we deal with the most strategic information inside a company. I don't want to I don't want to sign a contract where I am responsible for the whole security, right? So if Microsoft is what I have to use, perfect. But that also made us very, like, we're super clean on using software. Like, we use nothing. We use Google Drive, the same with piece of papers. We don't use Miro, and it's so interesting how a lot of people, when we started doing remote, were, you know, suggesting, and my feeling was always like, we don't need it. And there was a mantra for Mesa, which is like, everything you need and only what you need. So we are always questioning ourselves, do I really need this? And we decided to go with nothing. And that reinforced our belief that all you need to solve a problem is people. All you need to, it's the right piece of knowledge. So it's very clean. It's very like everyone's speaking on it's the closer we can get to the physical experience.
Yeah, so talking about closer to physical experience, have you ever thought about doing something in a VR environment and test that out? Because that is also somehow closer to this physical experience.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I don't know how much that would reflect the simplicity, just as a question.
Yeah, I think it's not the technology now is not exactly developed to the point that you could really do it without making the technology itself a protagonist, right? Like it's going to be really great when the technology is just there making the universe and you're not thinking about it. Right now, I think it's still too hard. But imagine, like, if you can really make people feel that they are together, then, yeah, like, why would you pay food for 20 people? Because the thing with the remote version, it's also way more democratic. Right, like it's cheaper.
Absolutely.
It makes the product more accessible to other people, which for me it's a huge value, right? And a lot of people again don't see that value. They're like, no, but I just want to hang with my friends, and I understand, right? So, but if I can give them the feeling of hanging with their friends, which I think high end technology will eventually be able to give us, then I think we have a really great format.
Yeah, and I mean, this accessibility, I think for us also, this was a very important decision when we decided to go remote first. It's like we are able to connect with talent and work with talent all over the world. And sometimes, you know, this talent really appreciate this opportunity much better, much more than somebody that would be wherever we are. So we see a huge difference also on productivity and also on engagement. Because
and
of
opening
that factor.
Doors to talent, right? Like
exactly.
I think that's a major part of it. Like we recently did a mesa with a really brilliant guy who has cerebral palsy, so like you know a level of body dysfunction that is really hard to be in. He wouldn't be able to come to a mesa, but he has his own chair. He can type on his own screen, his computer. It's all, and he was able to bring his talent into the table, which is something that he wasn't able before when I only did physical experiences. So I think of that a lot as well. But again, there isn't one perfect way. There won't be, you know, I can see all the, but I do think that people who lean towards global accessibility, really impactful work, you know, I think we'll see the value in being less and less structure based and more platform based. You know,
and have you ever tried to do something hybrid, like where we had like some people present and some people online?
Yeah, and it failed. It's horrible because then you become like two mesas. Like there's this people who can hang and these other people. So we don't do it anymore. We do hybrid final presentations, right? Like there's a final presentation, some people are present, we broadcast, but that's it.
Yeah, very interesting. Yes, I can see that. Yeah, it's always like if you are in this small world in your home or if you some are there, you try start creating this division. Yeah, I can totally see that happening. And what do you think it's just like the biggest challenges now moving forwards as the world is open again, as we are in this new context? Like, how do you see like the challenges for your organization, but also for the industry to how did something change? Or like, how do you see it?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. Right now, I look at all of us, and it's like we are super excited and super depressed, right? Like everyone is simultaneously depressed and excited, right? Like the beginning of the world, but also like it's weird we've just lived the pandemic. So I think that has a huge influence that people are gonna, you know, there is a growth in a macro environment where there is inflation in the US for the first time in years, things are expensive. And so I think there is a slowing down thing that will come, you know, like I can see it's gonna, my feeling is that there will be like a little bit of a slowing down, which I think it could be good for organizations to really, like we just went through major change, like, right? Like we navigated the pandemics. Everyone who survived and everyone who didn't either, like if you had your business thrive or if you had to change it dramatically and start something else, it's kind of, you've just been able to put your head above water now. And I think it's gonna be at, you know, there'll be 2023 might be a calmer, like not so many projects, so fast paced. Okay, I say that and then all of a sudden I'm like, who knows, you know, because I predicted 2021 to be a much like better year and it wasn't. So it's a little bit of like a bar talk here. No, I wouldn't hold myself.
But I understand, I mean, their markets are kind of like correcting. There is inflation, there's so much insecurity about supply chains and global.
Even traveling is like super expensive. So it forces a lot of us to just not travel so much right now, you know? So I think there will be a little bit of a slow pace. Or maybe I'm just hoping for it because it's also what I am going through. And also, I don't know, 2022 has had, like, we've been a little more responsible, I would say. Maybe it's like just getting a little older. Mesa turned 10 years, like a 10-year organization.
Wow, congratulations.
Thank you.
That's a long time.
It has a certain, like, maturity, right? Like, you already, so maybe for us, it's kind of also this moment where we are, like, taking the time to celebrate a few things. We're preparing this publication called Working With, where people who have been at Mesas talk about what they learned through working with someone else in a Mesa. So it's a beautiful celebration of our, like, the community. I think that's it. Like, I'm feeling a little bit like reflection time. Maybe it's just me, Ben.
Yeah, no, I can feel. I think there is we came out of this, like, COVID, government printing money, everybody in desperation mode, everybody trying different things and thinking the world will go digital. That's really amazing. And now you can see everything is reverting back to its original states, right? Like everybody thought like, oh, we go fully digital. Online shopping will be the only way after the COVID. But like, it seems that this is just like some anomaly within, like, of course the trend continues, but like we are reverting back to this. So I think there's a lot of truth into this moment of like, oh, we thought we were going somewhere else and now we're just like actually not. And actually there are lots of we are in a very complicated macro global situation that definitely requires us and organizations to understand their position there. And also, like, I think also in terms of innovation, right? We are also like in the innovation and growth technology evaluation has been very much corrected. So I guess there is a lot of like questioning on, like, there is a lot of thinking around like this whole capital boom of like technology companies and so on. So there's a lot of restructuring going on, and I think that is definitely reflected in your observation.
It's interesting. It's the times so that we're living. It's what we got in the gamble of life, right? We got 2020 and all the things that come with it.
And do you have anything? Do you have any thinking like you have this methodology that really effective and causing change and prototyping new ideas, and you've proven this method in several contexts. What is your thinking? Did you think about like how can this spirit and this way kind of be applied in a more continuous way after it's, because like it's kind of a dream, right? all those people come and they go to this like parallel dream world, which is called Beza, and then they experience a miracle, and then they have to go back to their life. It's like going to Burning Man, right? Go to Burning Man, everybody's like, oh, like everybody's so nice and everything's so beautiful. But then they come back to their reality, right? It's like, what does that mean? And how is there a way, or is there like a pragmatic pathway for people to bring that sort of learning
I would say I love the comparison with Burning Man. It's an honor to think that we are the work Burning Man, and I think it's true. I think the objective answer is no. I don't see a way of, like, I think the nature of Mesa is being able to make something be born, which requires extraordinary force, you know, to go from this doesn't exist, now it exists, right? Like a solution that didn't exist, now it exists. There is no formula you're copying. You're creating something. That requires extraordinary energy, especially if you, like we want it to be implemented. So like the whole purpose of Amaze is to build a solution that will be implemented by that organization. So it requires this force. So that, I think, you know, we've tried, even as a company, we've made models where we did like several Mesas to create something, and it works. Like, you, and I'll talk about it, but I think the straightforward answer would be no. Like, there are things that have certain purpose, and I feel Mesa has a little bit of that. That said, I think a lot of people who go through Mesas, even as a specialist, they are changed, and they change their view of what work can be. And so they come back to their daily life, which I think a lot of people can do, is more like genuinely curious, like really curious about, when you're in a work dynamic, normally you just assume people are a certain way. There's a lot of judgment that you need because you need to move fast in the environment of a corporation. I think after you do Amaze, you kind of understand the value of like letting people download things to you before you even start asking a question, you know, like just understanding. And also the fact that the best way to make a decision is not talking about it, is actually saying, okay, so what are you talking about? Show me what you, right? Like if you start as a leader in an organization, if you just start talking to your directs, the people you're directed responsible for, and telling them, we're going to enter this meeting and we're going to make a list of, or write the PR headline we would like for this, instead of just talking, 1 hour of conversation becoming 1 hour of like building something, that's a huge change. And I think a lot of people who go through Amaze speak about that. Like João Paulo Ferreira, who is the president of Natura, a Brazilian start, like a global company, right? Started in Brazil, but now they own Avon, they own Aesop. This guy, he says, like first Mesa he went through changed the approach he had to what a leader should be in an organization. If you start looking at the people who work with you and think, what is this person really great at? Like, I'm going to give this person a mission at something that they are actually great at, right? Like, not forcing them to be something else. Using this, we say, some people find it too pragmatic, like too utilitarian. But the idea for me as a leader, you're looking at your team as tools. You're thinking, like, I need a mission to be delivered, right? Like, I need this thing to be built. How do I use the best of this person? How do I make them a tool in this build of this construction? And I think that is an approach that has nothing to do with the 5 days, has nothing to do with assembling an extraordinary team. It's actually you in your daily life being more curious, letting people genuinely download stuff to you, listening to people, learning. For example, a super common mistake. Someone gets a new positioning and they get to a department and they know what's wrong with that department. They do not know. They don't know. Like if you're not opening to really learning on your first 3 weeks, 4 weeks, then I'm sorry, but you're going to make a lot of mistakes thinking that you know. Like you, and a lot of organizations lose long-term employees because they started not caring about the amount of knowledge that person built. You know, it's a hyper valuable thing. Very often we build teams and we say to like the client, oh, I need this person from logistics. And they're like, no, this person is not creative. I'm like, that's nothing to do with Mesa. Mesa, it's not about, I'm not assembling a team based on their personality. I'm assembling a team based on the pieces of knowledge and skills that this problem needs to be solved. And I need logistics. And very often this person becomes the most valuable player in the Mesa because they know so much. And then their pair, like someone who from the marketing department didn't even know, had full disrespect for someone who now all of a sudden they are like, fuck, what did I do? I missed years of learning from this person. And usually that happens. People, do you know what I mean? So I think like that goes back to our first conversation about legacy. We respect that kind of legacy very much, especially in times that you need to change. Because you can only change for real. You can only make an organization change for real if you understand where they come from, like where's their essence, and even help themselves see what's essence and what's stopping them from like moving forward, you know. So that's it. Like we really believe in this idea that people who are in a very long time at a certain organization, they have something super valuable to give.
That's really, really interesting. It makes me think about some things because we are working a lot with like organizations and helping organizations on organizing their communities, their partners, and so on. And one thing that made me think based on what you're saying is like, have you thought about like creating some sort of like alumni network of ex-Mesa participants from all those organizations and really try to like get them to meet once in a while and maybe just like write down, because that's what you're saying, like it's really interesting, write down what has changed. I'm just going back to this comparison with Burning Man, right? You change the way of you seeing the world and then you come back to the world and you start changing the world according to your learning, right? And so I guess all those people that have participated on the Mesa, they are changing their organizations now. And what are the experiments that they did?
Nice. Such a great idea.
What are the experiments that they did that worked and what did they learn and how could Mesa create a context for them to share that with each other and maybe even write down some sort of like a yearly publication. Let's say you had like this alumni network and then every year there will be like a series of conversations between them and try to gather all this know-how. And then you have like this yearly publication, like what has this group of people learned and what is this crowd insight or community insight from them after having gone through this experience. I think this could be really relevant.
I love that idea. I love the idea. I think there is the thing with producing content that good is that you need a really great content team. And we also, the fact that we come, a lot of Mesa leaders come from the editorial world makes us very like, if we want to produce content, we want to produce the content. But then we are leading Mesas. Then we have no time to, do you know what I mean? So it's kind of I love the idea. And a part of me thinks it's that moment of like, we should do it. And it's like, fuck, who's going to do it? How are
we help you do it? If you want to do it, we are on to helping you do it.
I love that idea.
Because I think that's really relevant. I think the world could learn a lot from it. And it's just not just based on your assumption, because I think it's always like, okay, you are the center of a Mesa and then you kind of, I interview you. But I think what's really interesting is like, what are all those people's insights based and how can we convey that in a way that other people can learn and even not having participated on the Mesa? And I think I think that could be really relevant and build like a learning community of all those people helping each other. In this organization, I tried to implement this. I stumbled upon this problem and then the other person, yes, but then I dealt with this. And really, really, I think people would be able to empower each other a lot.
Me too. Me too. Love that. Okay. So we're signing that contract.
Let's do it.
I love that idea. I think working with is a little bit of this attempt, right? Like when we thought, how do we celebrate 10 years of Mesa? The most important thing is the community, like is the people, you know, the learnings are there. When, I don't know, Swan was working with Jason, or, you know, somewhat two people who are working. But I think the way you're looking at it as something more consistent and frequent that people can actually access that community is really interesting.
Yeah, because these people are like learning. They enter this learning journey, right? They open their paradigm of thinking by experiencing this new way of working. And then they go back and mostly they are alone in their organizations. Now, like if you pair them with other people from other organizations who are also in the same journey of trying to bring that change back into the organization, then they are able to support each other to make that change possible, right? And then Mesa becomes just like a container for this network and supporting them to do what they want to do. I think that could be really powerful.
There's so many great people. That's it. As you said, like you're interviewing me, usually it's a Mesa leader, right, speaking about the method, but that's true. The people, imagine, in fact, we're assembled 15 people, you know, at least 10 people every Mesa. These are the, you know, there's so much learning there, so much.
Yeah, and what would be the format where they can exchange with each other and then exchange the best practice, what they've learned, and then what would be the method to put this in a concise way that people say, like, these are the 100 things that we've implemented. The stories, I think there's so much valuable content for you, for them, and for everybody that you, that I think, I just got me thinking out of the conversation here.
How do you usually, like, when you need a community, Pedro, do you have one where you reach out to?
Yeah, we help organizations to set up several communities. We use different types of technologies for that and different types of activation methods. But basically, we use a lot Discord, but I mean, Slack is also possible, but Discord is very community first. So as a way of things happen, and we automatize this with several bots. But then we do like various live activations, which is also something that we really like. It's like creating like ways for people to meet with each other. And then what we really like to do is we transcribe every conversation that we have between people. So we help, we have a methodology of like setting questions. And then we transcribe everything, and then we use some data analysis software to understand the patterns of each conversation. I mean, I can share some things with you. We just do this graph database, and then we understand, for example, what is the structural gap between that and that? What is the insights that you can get in there and that? And really try to understand what is the, we call it community insight. Because we think like it's very important to have some, to know what you're doing, but most important is to understand what people are learning and where are they and what are their questions. And I think when you have a community that shares something, being able to harvest those insights is fundamental for leaders or for whoever to understand moving forward. So we've done quite a few experiments on this and very successful with several organizations. And we are very excited about doing this kind of things. And I mean, if you're interested, we can talk more about it. Okay. But I think that looking into like how your community can empower each other, there's definitely a path forwards there for you.
Totally. Community, it's interesting. I feel there is a community at Mesa, even though we make give them no reward these days. Still, it's a flaw.
It's very hard. It's also a big topic, right? To organize and to structure and to understand how things connect, and also the utility, right? And I think like there are But I think as your organization, there might be very, very interesting things to think about. For example, you can have an utility, you could kind of launch an NFT where like everybody that participates on a Mesa gets this NFT. And with this NFT, they come to Discord and then they can log in, get to a special channel that does this, like various different things where you could kind of gamify this process. Obviously, there are people that are not Web3 friendly, but like,
yeah, I just feel the thing is, it's like that we go back to that mantra of like everything we need and only what we need, because yes. I see, you know, like I fear a little bit the potential of all things.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's also a really, really, really important point to think about. I just think that like you have the method and then what happens afterwards? This is my big question. How can you empower these people to bring the change of what they learned back to their communities?
I think that's kind of a service that really makes sense, you know, that people need, because people need to implement what they've been, right? Like you've just seen the solution you need to implement. And it's so true that it's hard.
And they can help each other, right? They can help each other.
Like, because we support someone, but not to a certain extent, right? Like they know that we support them, but we're not leaving...
Even supporting each other, you kind of could create different roles there, right? Because you could have supporters that want to take more responsibility and supporters that want to take less responsibility, the ones who take more responsibility. You could define their roles and really like, you really, really create a community with different roles. People love to take responsibility.
You see a lot of very successful cases, like TEDx, for example. I think it's a really successful case of like not centralizing the, you know, you have a little bit of control, you establish certain rules and then you let people use it, you know.
I don't even know if it's just like people using the Mesa method.
No, but then
it's more about like how do they bring this understanding in back to their lives? Because it's also like in Burning Man, people, you have like all those rules, but like, people come back to their lives and they change the way that they bring that insight into their work. I don't even think it's necessary that they will be implementing Mesas as their work, but they will implement a different way of working. And how do they change it? How do they do it? We don't know right now, right? And so just getting this insight could be very valuable.
Interesting. Yeah.
Anyway, it's just a broader conversation.
Yeah. It's good. We're creating something. It's the best kind of conversation when you're creating something with someone.
That is true. That is true.
Pedro, and how are you? Are you now, to start off my curiosity, are you now in Berlin? Is that it? Are you,
I'm in Berlin. I've been in Berlin this year, in Australia and everywhere else. And now we are here in the office in Berlin. I'll be in Berlin here and then I'll be back into Australia. And then I'm in Brazil at the beginning of next year. But yes.
Is Australia for work?
No, my wife is Australian. And so we go visit family, have a wedding there and so on.
Nice. Yeah. So you are like Brazil, Australia, two different sides of the world.
Right? Berlin, Brazil and Australia.
At least you've got a Berlin in the middle of the world.
Exactly. Australia is horrible because of the time zone. So it's really unlivable. I was there for 6 weeks and I was working from 7 p.m. to like 8 a.m. every day. And it's like, it's really, really tough. But I mean, I made it so far and I would just stay 2 weeks this year, I think, because it's just too much.
I did a Mesa with Australia at the peak of the pandemic. So, because there was a moment we were flying people to the same time zone, at least. We would fly our leaders to the same. But this Mesa, there was no way. So my official hours were 6 p.m. to 4 a.m.
And
tough.
Exactly. I did this for 6 weeks this year and we were starting a new project. We're starting a new venture with our organization. So it was also this beginning of times.
Yeah,
where we had to align, we were growing our team and so on. It was pretty tough, but we made it.
Nice. Yeah, I think time zones are the thing, right? Like sometimes we speak a remote format. It's like you can get anyone in the world apart from the time zone. So there's always constraints that we're having to deal with, making no solution perfect.
Yeah, amazing. So yes, I'm really, it's really exciting to hear about all your insights here. I think that there was a really fruitful conversation for everybody, and I'm sure people will be hearing and sharing and asking us further questions about it. And yes, and thanks so much
anyone,
for making
anyone
the time.
Wants to reach out, it's barbara@mesa.do. And Pedro, thank you so much.
Love yes, I will put I'll put all the information below, like, and I can also put your email if it's okay. You can put your email below on the description, and we will share that for everybody else. Yes.
Amazing. Big kiss. Thank you so much. Um grande beijo.